Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Paul Ogando.
Father God, we're so grateful, Lord, that you lead us, you speak to us, Lord, that Holy Spirit, you are the teacher of the church. Come and teach us what we ought to know, what we ought to hear, what we ought to learn. Father, you direct us, Lord. You can use anybody, so use me today, Lord. Father, we don't come to hear from young or old or any color that we can imagine, Father. We come to hear from you. So we're grateful that you will speak to us, Lord. We prepare our own hearts to receive the seed that will multiply and bring fruit in our own lives. And Lord, as we do that and as you bless us, we pray a blessing over the other churches that are in our Inland Empire and around the world. Father, we don't consider ourselves to be the only one preaching the true gospel. No, there's so many others, Father. So we pray for them also, that you'll bless them and advance them as they preach the gospel also in this area and around the world. We're grateful for them. In the mighty name of Jesus, we all say, amen. Amen. You may be seated. You know, tonight, we'll go through a little bit of a journey. And so, if you have your Bibles, I hope you do. Always bring one. We always look at the Bible here at The Rock. Is one of our values here as a church. And so pull out your phone or iPad, whatever you had. We're not against technology either. Like I always say, use your phone. Just don't text your buddy while you're doing it. Just kidding. Get your Bible there. And I want you to mark your Bible so you don't feel like you have to catch up, because I'm going to read a few verses. But we're going to start in 2 Samuel 16. 2 Samuel 16. We'll kind of flow through Isaiah. You can mark that if you want. And then we'll end in 1 Peter 2. 1 Peter 2. So 2 Samuel 16, we'll start there. And then we'll travel through the Bible, ending in 1 Peter chapter 2. Chapter 2. Let me read you a story before I give you the title of tonight's message. On February day in 1925, Floyd Collins climbed into Sand Cave in search of fortune. Suddenly, his lantern failed. Crawling through the darkness, Collins' foot hit a 7-ton boulder. It fell on his leg, trapping him. For days, Collins was trapped 125 feet below the ground in an icy space of 8 inches high by 12 feet long. In the meantime, his plight became a national sensation. As the rescue attempt wore on and on trying to get him out, some 50,000 people have gathered outside. And these tourists, they bought hot dogs, they bought balloons, they got soft drinks in the area of the cave in Kentucky. In the meantime, Floyd Collins died alone inside while screaming, "Get me out. Why don't you take me out?" I thought, man, that is a crazy story. Nobody wants to start a message with that either. Everybody's like, where is this guy going? Here's the title of the message, Avoiding the Trap. Avoiding the Trap. Many of us are in situations in our lives where we are absolutely just like Floyd Collins. We're crawling through life, going through life, trying to do something exciting or accomplishing our mission, and we don't know when we'll hit a snag. It would absolutely trap us. And the Word of God says there is one particular trap that is absolutely dangerous to every Christian. As a matter of fact, to every human, but specifically to those who believe in Christ. And as we discover this trap, which is not new to you, but we want to see it from a different light and a different path, God wants us to absolutely be aware of that. So we don't end up like Floyd Collins. While people are watching me dying, I'm screaming, somebody get me out, and they're eating their hot dogs and drinking their sodas, watching me fade away. Guess what? I don't want to be the guy doing that. I don't want to be the one, neither any of our pastors, anybody on staff, eating the hot dogs and consuming the soda while you wither away in this trap. And that is why we take the time and the moment to teach the word so that we can grow together and learn together. And that's where I begin my story tonight in 2 Samuel chapter 16. 2 Samuel chapter 16, as you go there, this is an amazing story, because what's going on in 2 Samuel is that King David, as you may know, he committed adultery with a lady named Bathsheba, and so got her pregnant. She eventually lost the pregnancy, but in the meantime, he had her husband killed because he wanted to hide the pregnancy, and he wouldn't cooperate with sleeping with her. I mean, absolute disaster. All in the meantime, Absalom, one of David's kids, was absolutely upset at him because David did not take ownership of a situation that's happened where a half-brother of Absalom raped his sister. And the family is a mess. I mean, you don't have to be watching Jerry Spring. Jerry Spring, I dated myself there. You know, that was a long time ago. Whatever. One of those shows, you know. Maury, I don't know what they show nowadays. I'm glad I don't watch those things. But, you know, it's all in the Bible. It's a really mess. I mean, David's got a mess going on in his hands. And so Nathan, the prophet, a prophet side of this, he said, man, you're going to be forgiven, but you're going to see nothing but war in your house. You're going to have to struggle through a lot of things. And from that day on, David saw no peace till the day he died. And so what's going on here is that Absalom has rebelled against David, kicked him out. David runs. He doesn't want to fight his kid or kill him. He runs out because already Absalom is so angry at his dad, decides to take the kingdom. Then David calls one of his kings or his dad's advisors. His name is Ahithophel. And if somebody's pregnant, having a kid, there goes the name for you. So Ahithophel was an advisor. And the Bible says this guy was brilliant. Listen to this. Listen how the Bible says it. Verse 23, chapter 16. I want you to notice this before I read to you the rest of the story. 2 Samuel 16:23 says, now the advice of Ahithophel, which he gave in those days, was as if one had inquired at the oracle of God. Let me translate that to you. When that guy spoke, it was as if you were hearing the voice of God. And so it was all the advice of Ahithophel for both David and Absalom. Are you kidding me? Whatever this guy said, they took it as God is speaking to me. But the thing got complicated. See, Ahithophel stays with Absalom, and I'll tell you in a minute why. And then in chapter 17, we see that Absalom says, hey, what should I do? You're an advisor. What should I do to capture my dad? How do I take revenge? And Ahithophel, leading up to this, says the following before chapter verse 23. He says, what you got to do is you have to defile and tell people, let the people show that you're in control. Go and sleep with your the concubines of your dad's. And the Bible says that he took it up a notch. Absalom was absolutely wicked, put a tent in the plaza so that everybody could see him being with his father's concubines. This was a crazy mess. And it was all because of one trap. One trap. And this is why avoiding this trap is so crucial in our life, because it will lead us through a path that absolutely destroys everything that we're planning for in our lives. Are you with me tonight? You don't want to get stuck in there while others consume their beverages and watch you die. We don't want to do that. God doesn't want you to do that. So he says, what should I do? Ahithophel says, King Absalom, don't bother yourself. Give me 12,000 of your men. I will go out into battle, since now your dad, King David, is tired and weary. I will catch him and kill only him. Ooh. He wasn't out for blood. He was out for David. It was out for David. And so the Bible says that Absalom said, you know what? I like your advice, but I want to check with one more advisor. And that's when he called the other advisor, King David, which God has placed there to protect him. And in verse 7 of chapter 17 says, so Hushai, which was the other advisor, said to Absalom, the advice that Ahithophel has given is not good at this time. Can you say at this time? This is so important that you understand this. And the reason why Ahithophel is absolutely mad and angry at David, many historians believe, because it's later mentioned that in the Bible, that he is the grandfather of Bathsheba. So here's Ahithophel saying, I want David. He got my granddaughter pregnant. He insulted my family. And he gets away with it. I'm going to get him. And when we decide that vengeance is ours because of something done to us, we start walking in a very treacherous path. Can you say again, at this time? The advice of Ahithophel has given is not good at this time. Let me tell you something. As a pastor, I hear a lot talking to people, and there's so many people throwing their lives away because in one particular moment, somebody didn't do what they asked them to do. Somebody didn't do the idea you gave. Somebody didn't follow through with the thing you think is the best. And people absolutely just take on their life because at this moment, it didn't happen. And let me prove it to you. Go to verse 23 of chapter 17. Something ensues. They start talking. Things start happening. All of a sudden, this is what you get. 2 Samuel 17, 23. Look at this. Now, when Ahithophel saw that his advice was not followed, he saddled a donkey, arose, and went home to his house to the city. Part B says the following. Then he put his house in order and hanged himself and died. I'm not trying to preach death tonight. It has nothing to do with physical death, the message I'm giving you. Even though some people have taken it that far, obviously we see it here. Talking about with people that many people today are in the way, in a way or another, killing their future when they respond to life in the way that Ahithophel did. You cannot respond to life by defining your entire life by the one moment. At this time, the God... Didn't you read verse 23, chapter 16 with me? It says that what he said, it was as if God was speaking. And later in 17:23 says, he hangs himself because he didn't listen to what he said. The reason why he ends up that way is because he took on offense against David. And there's nothing worse than a broken spirit and an offended heart. It absolutely will crush you. It absolutely will crush you. A broken and offended spirit is the fastest way to kill your future. A broken and offended spirit is the fastest way to kill your future, the fastest way. And so all of us in our own lives, and we have to work at this and continue to work at this. This is an ongoing process because things are going to happen to you that will lead you that way if you don't focus in what God wants you to do. So dangerous. Proverbs puts it this way. It says, an offended friend is harder to win back than a fortified city. How many? Say amen. Don't raise your hand. An argument separates friends like a gate locked with bars. Think about that. I mean, an offended heart is so divisive, so destructive. We have to be careful to not become reactionary people of the one time moment. Let me tell you, I'm not preaching to you. I have preached this to myself for years now before I can say this to you. So what I'm saying to you tonight, I've put into practice and continue to do to this day. Because I didn't want my future to die. And God doesn't want your future. As a matter of fact, this is what he says about you. Jeremiah 29:11 says, I know the plans, the thoughts I think about you. They're good and not evil. I want to give you a future and a hope. That's what he says. So he's not wanting you to die or choke by the wayside because you're not looking at what's going on inside. Reactionary. I am a very, I'm learning as the years go by. As you may know, I share with you, I'm a very sort of reactionary driver. I'm in my focus. I'm point A to point B. You know, I don't do a lot of in-betweens. I planned everything. And so that's just how I am. That's my personality, my makeup, how God designed me. And so I remember one time we're going to a wedding. And so we're listening to this beautiful romantic song, Christian song, and my wife is putting on her makeup in the car, and I'm driving, you know, suited up, and I have this guy just tailing me the whole time. How many men say amen that something's about to go down, yeah? No? Okay. I mean, this guy's telling me, so I turn into the canyon. There's nowhere to go, only one lane, you know? So I turn into the canyon right up here. I don't know which way am I, that way, something like that. So I turn into the canyon, and so, I mean, this guy's on me. I'm like, what am I doing? I'm looking at my speed. I'm, you know, trying to be, my plaque in the back says the Rock Church. I got to behave, you know, kind of deal. Can't do much. So I'm just like, what in the world's going on, you know? Finally, I just like, what? I mean, this guy was just on me. I just go, rah, and pull to the side, you know, and just pull the window down and just go like this, like, get away from me, you know? And so my wife's like, what happened? I'm like, this guy's on me the whole time. And she's like, oh, my gosh, we're having such a good time. Listen to a beautiful song. And then she said, what if those guys are going to the wedding too? I'm like, oh, man. And we're in trouble, you know? It's going down when we get there. You just never know. You just never know. Even though something's happening behind you and maybe to you, you don't know what the outcome of that will be in the future. So don't strangle what God is wanting to do because of the moment. The moment. Here's what I want to cover with you tonight. preserving my future. And God, how do I do that? How do I preserve my future? How do I get a hold of it and say, Lord, I don't want to end like this guy. I don't want to end trapped. I want to avoid the trap that will absolutely hinder me from obtaining the future that you have built for me. And the number one thing you got to do is you have to watch what you're thinking. You have to watch what you're thinking. You have to work on your thought pattern in your life. And this is something, again, I'm preaching to myself before I preach it to you. You have to work out. This is something that doesn't stop. It takes time, because the habits you built over years don't disappear right away. Are you with me? Very, very important. I mean, it's just the same way, and I'm not speaking to anyone, I'm speaking to myself, the same way we gain weight, we want to lose it by the next week. I mean, that's just a reality for all of us. Yes, amen. Few honest people, including the pastor. So that's just the reality, you know. And so in the same manner, in your thought process, the same way, the same when you gain it, it's just going to be. So you have to watch, how are you considering this? The children of Israel were absolutely, I mean, they did this all the time. They would walk away from God constantly. They would come to God, God, forgive us, we made a mess, oh my gosh. And God would say, all right, well, let's get on with it. You know, I have a promise I gave to Abraham, Jacob. I mean, just God reaffirmed them. And so they go on and things get great, and all of a sudden they just forget. I mean, they're just this constant cycle. We kind of all do that. If we're honest with ourselves, we kind of all do that in some way, in some respect. But God wants a certain consistency from you and I in order to do what he's asking you to do. And that begins with the way I think. And honestly, I'm preaching to the choir tonight, because you guys who come Wednesday, you guys put out an effort to be, I'm not just going to be a Sunday person. I'm going to be here. I'm going to make an effort. I'm going to leave work, get here. So you guys are really working at this, okay? And this is very important. I'm not trying to come down on you, but I'm trying to show you that in order to preserve the future, your thinking comes with it. Are you with me? The transformation of what's in us has to come with it. Everything we do has to come with it. As a matter of fact, I was telling my wife, this is so amazing. Just today, I'm changing, and I said, I don't like this shirt. And because it looks a little like I'm going to school, I tell her. She's like, no, it doesn't look like school. She says, as a matter of fact, it looks like a school because it's in your country. And I said, that is so true. My country, most school uniforms are plaid shirt with jeans or slacks. So when I put it on, I was like, my thinking took me to something I've experienced. Are you with me today? Some of you guys, sights and smell and things. And so there are things in your mind already that you've built that you say, man, unless I watch them, I have to be careful. Here's a word of Isaiah for the children of Israel. Isaiah gets a calling as a prophet, say, you have to prophesy to these people to correct their way, because I'm sending Jesus. He doesn't specifically say that, but saying I'm sending hope, I'm sending the light, I'm sending you something that's going to change. And here's the first word, Isaiah 8. I'll read it for you. In the NIV version, says the following. It says, this is what the Lord says to me. With his strong hand upon me, man, Isaiah's making it a point saying, God was on me when I heard this, warning me not to follow the way of this people. Warning me not to follow the way of this people. Another version says, warning me not to think like they think. Not to think like they think. Here's how they were thinking. And tell me if you don't relate to this, especially nowadays. Look at this. Verse 12 says, do not call conspiracy everything this people calls a conspiracy. Should I mention some TV channels and news channels? Do not fear what they fear, and do not dread it. Here's what the Lord's saying. Don't think like the people who are out there thinking. Don't do that. You have to change your thinking, change your behavior. I mean, we see it nowadays. Everything is absolutely present, especially in a society that is online, that is immediate. As a matter of fact, I took a Facebook off of my phone because I hated the interruption. I hated the desire to want to go check and want to go find out. So I just took it off my phone. I said, forget it. I'm not wasting time in this stuff, because it was so crazy. And what drew me to that is, I'm not trying to be political, okay? I'm not trying to be political, but it was so, just reading some of my friends, some things, everybody commenting about the lion that got killed in Zimbabwe and all this stuff, and I'm thinking, well, yeah, that's sad, you know, and nobody wants that, but it was a big uproar. I mean, just everybody, man, this lion got killed and everything. Then I find this small little article, tiny little article. They interview a man from Zimbabwe, in Zimbabwe, and these are his words from there. What is the big deal? Nobody writes an article when a lion kills a person. I thought, wow, how interesting. How interesting. A guy from the same, here we are, tons of miles away from the situation. We have taken on someone else's offense. And you know what? I used to do that a lot. It used to get me in trouble a lot. And I've learned, that's their problem. Now, some things are worthy to fight. Please don't get me wrong. The same people that talked about the lion has said nothing about Planned Parenthood. Same people. This is what I mean. This is why God told Isaiah, do not call the conspiracy people are talking about. Don't behave that way. You have to change right here. It's right here. And this is what the Lord says to him. It's right here. Am I scaring you? You ready to run out of here? Verse 13, the Lord Almighty is the one you are to regard as holy. The Lord Almighty, he is the one you are to fear. He is the one you are to have the dread. He's the one you have to look. God, whatever you want, I want. What you say is bad, I want to call it bad. What you say is good, that's going to be good for me. It's God. It's the Lord Almighty. Verse 14, he will be a holy place for both Israel and Judah. He will be a stone. And this is a prophecy about Jesus that causes people to stumble and a rock that makes them fall. And for the people of Jerusalem, he will be a trap and a snare. You know what he's saying? He's saying for people who cannot embrace the word of God, it'll become a stumbling block. When you read certain things, you're like, wow, that just sounds, man, so poignant. This is the same thing. I'm so glad God did it that way because I didn't plan it that way. This is the same thing. The disciples found a stone, meaning when Jesus said, unless you eat of my flesh and drink of my blood, you're not going to partake. And the disciples said, wow, that's brutal. And Jesus said, so are you going to go? And they said, no, you're the only one with words of life. You're the only one. The disciples said, I'll change my thinking. I'll change my thinking. When I see the stone that's going to lead me to stumble, I'd rather embrace it instead of breaking on it. I'd rather embrace instead of breaking it. Because what tends to happen is this. What tends to happen is that the desire for something else, listen to this, takes away the joy of what I do have. The desire of something else takes away the joy of what I do have. You may have a really good thing, but because you're not enjoying it now, you think, man, I need to have something else. And Jesus is saying, no, change your thinking, change your thinking, change your thinking. And it's so important for us to do that, for us to look at our situation. Lord, help me evaluate what I'm currently at. How do I do this? How do I change? Before you change anything, start with that in your life. Are you with me tonight? Point number two today, very important. Get closer to God. And that's kind of like a given, but I needed to mention that because it's so important. Because in the days of being offended, in the days of darkness, in the days when things are happening, the most important thing to do is actually to draw near to God instead of away from God. Many of us tend to run from God. As a matter of fact, I read a lot of blogs and things as a Christian blog, just kind of staying up on what things happen. You know what is the number one comment people make why they left the church? It's hypocrisy. And I'm like, that is so funny. That is so funny to me. Because the whole point why we came to church is because we need Jesus to change what we are on the inside. You know what? I've been in church all my life. I've seen hypocrisy. I've seen theft in church. I've seen people steal money. I've seen people fail, cheat. I haven't left the church because that is not a reflection of God. That's a reflection of humanity, broken people. That's what that is. It's just broken people in church. That's what that is, not God. God doesn't do that, not to you, not to anyone else. He loves you so much. He sent his only begotten son so that you may have eternal life with him. Somebody that's really to hurt you will never do that. Will never do that. And this is why it's important to change our thinking and how we view things by drawing near to God and not just near to people in general. Don't we have to be in relationship with people? This is really important. Peter starts by saying the following in 2 Peter. So 1 Peter chapter 2, go there. Go there. This is so, I love this. And again, this topic is so enormous in the Word of God. I can go through a million different prophecies. In the book of Matthew, Jesus mentions himself to his cousin John, hey, don't stumble, don't get offended with what I'm doing. And in the book of Romans, Paul says, those who didn't have faith stumble on Jesus, on the truth of Jesus. So there's a lot of this being that rock that's a pillar. 1 Peter 2, Peter starts by saying, listen, those who says you have to abandon all the bad things you've done, your envy, your that, I don't have it for you, but let's get it together because this is so powerful. I should have put it there, but I thought I didn't have time. This is how he starts. He says, therefore, laying aside all the malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, evil speaking, as a newborn babe, desire pure milk of the word. This is how he starts. He says, hey, listen, all of you guys, all of us in church, let's put aside all the junk we came in with and start desiring the word of God as a babe wants that milk to be fed and nurtured. That is so powerful. There is tons of scientific study that says that the milk the mother produces cannot be engineered. There is no human engineering that can reproduce the purity, the nutrient, everything that's produced. And Peter's saying, that same way, the word of God gives you absolutely everything you need. Listen to this. No one can engineer the word of God for you. No one can make it. We can explain it. We can preach it. We can teach it. But until you get it into you, it's not going to affect your life and your walk. No one can engineer that. So Peter's saying you have to desire it. And then he goes on to say this, verse 4. If I can get it up here, verse 4 says, come into him. Come into who? Jesus. Jesus, only Jesus. This is why that song is so powerful. Only Jesus. Come into him as a living stone. Rejected indeed by men, but chosen by God and precious. Saying, you know, the children of Israel, they want nothing to do with it. Some people in the children of Israel. But he said, you know what? Desire it. Now listen to this. Now it goes to us. Verse 5. You also. Say, you also. He's saying, you and I, in the same manner that draw near to God, you also, look what we are. You also, as a living stone, are being built up as a spiritual house, the holy priesthood, to offer a spiritual sacrifice is acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. Here's the reality. As Jesus is living stone, so are you. You are the reflection of God wherever you go. And people are only going to evaluate God based on that. This is so crucial. So crucial because this is how it affects us. As a matter of fact, I was reading an article that blew me away. You probably know this, but I just want to mention. And we all know what happened in Charleston, South Carolina, the shooting of the AME church. Methodist church has been standing there for many, many years. But what blew the whole nation away was the fact that one man wanted to do something. He wanted to start a racial war. That was his desire. But the one resounding thing about AME church is the fact that the day of the trial, everybody said, we forgive you. We forgive you. Listen to this. Anthony Thompson, the husband of 59-year-old Myra Thompson, one of the persons killed, said, I forgive you and my family forgives you. But we would like you, telling the guy, we would like you to take this opportunity to repent and change your ways. Are you kidding me? That's amazing. Listen, his wife's dead. The grandson of 74-year-old Daniel Simmons says, although my grandfather and the other victims died in the hands of hate, this is proof. Everyone's plea for your soul is to prove they live in love and their legacies will be lived in love. She ends up by saying, so hate one win. Here's one that really touched me because it's so true for all of us who are in the process. She said, for me, I'm a work in progress, admitted relative of 49-year-old DePayne Middleton doctor. I am very angry, but we're a family that love built. And we have no room for hate, so I have to forgive you. You know what she did? She's preserving her future. She said, I don't like what you did. As a matter of fact, I'm still angry, but I'm gonna forgive you. I have to forgive you. I have to make an effort. Nobody's approving with what he did, but everybody's drawing near to God in order to preserve their future ongoing. And it's just so crucial that we don't judge our life by that one moment. These people have experienced tremendous pain. And they're saying, you know what? It's not worth it. I was watching a SportsCenter documentary, especially on this. There's a young man whose mother died there, one of the young mothers. She was a coach and a trainer, a track and field trainer for the high school. And they interview this young man, and he says something that was drawing me today. He said, you know what? They asked him towards the end of the interview, how do you deal with it? He said, if I sit there and think that some guy just shot my mom, said it will destroy my life. So I don't live my life based on what I'm thinking. He wanted to destroy us, and what he did is he brought us together. My friends, that is a picture of the body of Christ. That is a picture of the body of Christ that we fight through by getting closer to God, by applying the principles of the kingdom when things get hard. That's when it matters. That's when it matters. As a matter of fact, in the word of God, anytime you want to see a victory, they had to go through war. They had to prove what was on the inside of them. That's the reality. So God wants that for us. So the Apostle Peter gives us two reactions to the trap. Two reactions to the trap. And if you give me a few more minutes, I want to kind of get you there and end with this. Two reactions to the trap placed before us. Reaction number one, and point number three for today, reaction number one is, if you have faith, his truth, which is his word, is precious to you. If you have faith, if you believe, his truth, his word becomes precious to you. For these people, in a moment of terrible pain, when their family members were murdered for no reason, God's truth became their solace. God's truth became precious because they believe. They wanted to connect with God in that area. As a matter of fact, here's what Peter says. Verse 6, he says the following. Therefore, it is also contained in the scripture. Where is it contained? In the scripture, right here, right here. He's saying, right here, you got to love it. Contain the scripture. Behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect and precious. And he who believes on him will by no means be put to shame. My friends, you're not going to be embarrassed when you walk with Christ. You might be in embarrassing situations. People might try to embarrass and diminish you. But you and your future will not be an embarrassment. You will not. You will not be put to shame. You will not be put to shame. And we have to remind ourselves of that because we make such an investment in our Christian walk and we think, man, what's it going to be? God is working at something. I tell you, my family is a perfect example. Just tonight, I was actually shocked just tonight of what God is doing to my family. I've shared with you a little bit, but I see it more and more, especially through online interaction. And Pastor Joel posted that I'll be preaching tonight. And some of my aunties from the Dominican Republic, where I'm from, and started commenting and say, oh, way to go. And Pastor, and we love you and all this and several of them. Now, that may sound cool now. A few of my cousins, more than three, are going to churches now. They're fully devoted followers of Christ. They're Christians. And I tell you, for more than 20 plus years, my mom, my sister, and I were the only Christians in our family. We're the only Christians. I was made fun of because I didn't go to clubs. I was made fun of because I didn't have tons of girlfriends. My mom was made fun of for different things. Oh, we can't do this. We can't do that. We can't go. All this, that. And little by little, we were not put to shame because we hold on to the God as the precious word. As the center of everything. And I'm telling you, you hold on. If you're being made fun of, you hold on because you won't be put to shame. As a matter of fact, look what he says, verse 7. He says the following. Therefore, you who believe, he is precious. He becomes beautiful. He becomes amazing. He becomes the center. Jesus, only Jesus, when you believe, when you are in those times of difficulty, you get closer to God. Those who have faith will see the word of God as something precious, something to behold and be close to. So important. Don't let anybody shame you. You keep on keeping on because God is going to do something amazing in you. Here's the second reaction. Give a hand to God if you're going to do it. He deserves it. Here's the second reaction and point number four for tonight. When you don't believe, you get offended. When you don't believe, you get offended. And that's a reality, my friends. That, as a pastor, I live it all the time, and as friends, and there's certain things in the Word of God that rub us the wrong way. And when we choose not to believe it, we become offended. We become hard, whether it be money, whether it be forgiveness, whether it be prayer, whether it be fasting, whether it be worship. Hey, do I really have to raise my hand? Come on, God can see it. God, don't be so narrow-minded, square, whatever. You know, I don't know. People say nowadays. But, you know, it's just all these things. It says, for those who believe, everything is precious. For those who don't believe, then they get offended. And you have to take a posture of, God, I want to believe. I want to be as innocent as a child. My children ask the most interesting questions of the Word of God. Super interesting because to them, this is all new. To them, this is all amazing. My daughter is, my wife, as a matter of fact, I had to talk to some of the parents because my daughter just laid onto this little girl across the street telling her, out of love, I don't want you to go to hell. She took her Bible with her. So I want you to come to Christ. She was my daughter's 7 years old, she was telling this girl, and she was really concerned. She's like, Mom, she's going to go to hell. She's not going to be with us. And, I mean, she was truly concerned for her friend. And it was so precious because she took it face value. She didn't question, said, this is what it got to be. Then I'm going to talk because she's my friend and I want her to be with me wherever I'm going. Can you imagine that? Sometimes I ask myself, God, when did I lose that childlike heart? You know, life kind of hits us in all kinds of angles and we just cover ourselves up, including myself. I'm not accusing you. And I pray that prayer, Lord, help me be childlike in many areas of my life. Because God said, that's how you inherit the kingdom. It belongs to them. Because they just look at Jesus and say, it's all about Jesus. I'm just going to do it the way he's asking me to do it. I'm just going to receive it the way he's wanting me to receive it. Because when you believe, he's precious. But when you don't, you get offended. When you don't, it becomes hard. When you don't, things grind you down. When you don't, then just you don't receive it the same way. Here's how Peter ends it. Peter ends it this way. He says, therefore, you who believe, he's precious. But those who are disobedient, and that word, even though it was translated disobedient, the original language in one of the translations says, for those who don't believe, who are disobedient, the stone which the builders reject, they're talking about Jesus, have become the chief corners, have become the center of everything we do, verse 8, and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense, they stumble. Here's the reason why. Being disobedient to the word. They stumble being disobedient to the word. And so we trip ourselves up when we don't look at the word of God in a manner that affects our life, in a manner that we can let it just work in us, drive us, build us, direct us. Are you with me tonight? And so God is inviting us tonight, church, listen to this, to not end our lives like Mr. Collins, crawling through life, not knowing where we're going, putting ourselves in a predicament, getting stuck, while people watch us fade away and celebrate to see if we're going to get out of this mess or not. Here's what God wants. He says, embrace me completely. Get closer to me. Do not let offense drive you away from me. Do not let offense drive you away from church. There's always a reason to get offended. I was talking to a lady who turned 80 years old last week, and she's been in our church for many years. She's been a Christian for 29 plus years. She told me something. She said, Pastor Paul, she's the cutest little girl, Sarah. She's like that, 80 years old, beautiful missionary to Mexico. And she said, there's always a reason to get offended. But we don't. And I said, when a lady 80 years old tells me you don't get offended, you don't get offended, my friend. That's just the way it goes. Here's what she's saying. I've lived this life. I walk with Christ. There's always a reason to get bent out of shape. But if we receive the word as it comes, with a beautiful heart, nothing will trip us. I'll end with this. Psalm. I love this psalm. I love this psalm. Psalm 119, 165 says, great peace have those who love your law, and nothing causes them to stumble. Can we read that together out loud like you believe it? 1, 2, 3. Great peace have those who love your law, and nothing causes them to stumble. That's the word of God for you tonight. If you receive it, give him a hand. God is so good and precious. Listen, I want to go straight into checking your soul. We're actually early. I don't have a lot of words, so I pray you give me 5 minutes before we do anything else. 5 minutes of your time. I don't take any longer than that. 5 minutes of your time, and you'll be on your way. As a matter of fact, youth and children are still going. Just give me 5 minutes of your time. We talked about something so crucial. And I want to challenge you in an area of your life before we move on and do anything else in service. There's very important things we want to go over, but I want to do this before we do anything else because God has already spoken to you. God's already spoken to you. Remember how my daughter said, I don't want my friend to go to hell? My daughter took the value of the word of God, face value. She said, that's what it says, I'm going to believe it. How about you? What if I ask you if today was the last day you are on this earth, and you die, this ends. Would you open your eyes in heaven or in hell? Most people, this is a common thing. In America, it's probably 80%. Among Hispanics, it's 92%. Here's the answer. We're going to heaven. We're going to heaven. We were raised going to church. We were raised respecting God. We were raised honoring our grandmas, took us to church. We did all these things. You know, some people come from that background. They told us, if you're a good person, you make it into heaven. You know what's interesting? Nowhere in the Word of God says that because you're a good person, you will enter into heaven. There's not one place. I'm glad you're good. I'm glad you're a decent social person, but that is not a qualification to make it into heaven. As a matter of fact, in the book of Isaiah, it says that if you think because you do good things, because you help at over here and there and give to the poor and do these wonderful things and your house is green and your footprint is small, whatever they call it today, you're amazing. You know what it says? If you think that's going to get you into heaven, that is like garbage to God. Book of Isaiah. Pastor, so how do I get there? Because I went to church. As a matter of fact, when I went to church, I went to the kids' class when I was a little kid, and I learned a verse. I still remember the verse. Man, I'm glad you did that. I'm glad you've done those things. Those things are good. I did too. I went to class. I went to catechism class. Some people went to Sunday school class. They learned a verse. But that, according to this, is not a qualification to make it into heaven. Listen to this. The Bible says that demons believe and tremble. They're not going to heaven. Here's what's amazing. Satan, the enemy, that guy, he recites verses from memory to Jesus when he tempts him. You can read it. From memory, he tells him, hey, your word says this and that. Isn't that amazing? Guess what? He's not going to heaven either. So God is not looking for really smart biblical people. Not interested. Here's what he's looking for. Watch this. Right here. For a heart. And here, how he does it. He talks to a man by the name of Nicodemus. This man was very important. He was a leader of his church, of his days. John 3:1 says he was very important. He was a crucial person of the synagogue. I mean, this man dressed the part. This man knew the part. This man spoke the part. This man was amazing. Yet it is to that guy, that Jesus, look what he says. He says, to see the kingdom of God, look at the word, you must be born again. The problem with born again is that in America, we've made it a comical thing. In every movie, the born again person is an idiot. And so we assume, if I'm going to be born again, I have to be an idiot. What a sad story when that is so far from truth. Only brave people decide to trust God and walk with him. And that is what God is asking of you today. In a moment, this is how we do it in this church. In a moment, I'm going to count to three. I'm going to hit my Bible, and I want you to raise your hand right where you're sitting. And when you do that, you're saying, Pastor, I want to ask Jesus to come into my heart. I need him tonight. I want to be solid with him. But you may be thinking, Pastor, I don't want to raise my hand. I want to do just a quiet prayer in my seat. Doesn't that count? You know what? Look what the Word of God says in the book of Luke. He says the following. Look what it says. It says, if you acknowledge me before men, I will acknowledge you before my Father. But if you deny me, if you sit there and say, that's not for me, he says, I will deny you. He doesn't want to deny you. He went to a cross and died for you because he loves you. Here's what he wants. He wants you to acknowledge and say, God, I need you. Because the Bible says, when you draw near to him, he will draw near to you. When you take that step, God is ready to reach out and touch you. That's what he wants from you tonight. Who should raise your hand? When I count to three, if you're in the fences, if you're saying, well, maybe I should, you should. If maybe you pray, Pastor, I made that prayer a long time ago, but your life did not follow what you said with your mouth, it is time to make a change. Who should make this prayer tonight? Those sitting there knowing, God spoke to me. I got to make a change. I'm not right with him tonight. I need to do that. And when you raise your hand, together we'll pray right here, inviting Jesus into your heart. So if that's you, if God spoke to you tonight, I count to three, I hit my Bible, you raise your hand, and we'll pray together. One, two, three. Is there anybody here? This is your night. Thank you. Two, three, thank you. Four, five, thank you. Six, seven, thank you. Eight, nine, thanks. It's awesome. I see those hands. I see a number 10. Oh, 11, thank you. It's awesome. Is there anyone else tonight? Is there anyone else saying, right here, thank you, 12, 13, that's awesome. Put your hand down, I see it, thank you, rest your hand. Is there anyone else saying, man, 13 wise people said, I want that tonight. Thank you, I saw it, that's awesome, I saw your hand, thank you. You're saying, God, this is it, I got to do this tonight. God is speaking to you, don't let this moment pass you by. This is your moment. I had to do it, many people in this room had to do it at some point. We did not die. We actually received life. We weren't embarrassed. We actually were joyful that we made that decision. God is inviting you tonight to do that. Is there anyone else other than those 13 hands? You know you're there. You're fighting. Man, should I? You should. Just say, you know what? This is my night. I'm making a change. I'm starting tonight. Thank you, sir. God bless you. Is there anyone else saying, this is my night? It's my night. I came and this is my night. I can feel you out there. God is speaking to you. I'm giving you a moment. This is your moment. Be brave for God and say, you were brave for me. I'm going to be brave for you. Is there anyone else tonight? And then we'll pray. Thank you. God bless you. 15, that's awesome. Can we give a hand to the Lord for that? 15 wise people. That's so great. So great. Here's how we're going to do this. In a moment, we're all going to stand. When we all stand, those 15 that raise their hand, and those that should have but didn't, I want you to be brave just like they will be. Grab your coat, sweater, purse. Don't leave anything in your seat. Meet me right here so we can pray together, inviting Jesus into your heart and get some stuff into your hands that's going to help you walk with the Lord. Would you stand and give them a hand tonight as they come down? Come on, join us tonight as we pray together. Be brave. This is your moment. Take the step. I will meet you right here. Let's pray together.
As you are, oh, when you hear,
thank you. Hey, listen, you guys are up here. Would you give me just a minute? Because I feel there's a few others struggling with the decision, and I want to give them a time. I mean, we could celebrate this. There you are. There you are. Come on down. God is with you. Is there anyone else just like him? Say, I'm struggling with this, but I need this moment. God has already spoken to you. All we're doing is giving you the opportunity. Is there anyone else? And I say, I got to get myself. Thank you for doing it. Good job. That's how you do it. Come on down. Here they come. God is waiting on you guys. Good job. Come on, get yourself down here. God is so good. It's all God. Only Jesus. Only Jesus. Come on. A whole family just walking in the Lord. Good job. That's awesome. Let's do this. I love doing this. I'm going to kind of steal this moment from Pastor Joel. I love praying with you guys. And this whole congregation, we want to pray together. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to repeat some words, all of us. And those words are not magical, some abracadabra. You're saying what's in your heart. God sees your heart. He reads your lips, but he sees your heart. And when the intention of your heart is right, that moment, new life begins. You're inviting Jesus to forgive you, to live, to lead you from this moment forward. Can we greet them by doing this? Can we do it together? Let's do this. Let's pray together. As they, while they pray together, say in agreement, Father God, I invite you into my life to be my Lord and my Savior. I acknowledge that I've sinned against you, that I've committed sins that have hurt you and others. But now I receive your forgiveness. I receive your washing by the sacrifice of your Son. Tonight, I'm a new person. Tonight, I'm your child. Starting today, I'm walking with you from this day and until eternity. Fill me with your Holy Spirit this very moment. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Awesome. Let's do this. Pastor Joel, one of our pastors and leaders here at The Rock, he wants to put something in your hand. He wants to give you information. He wants to help you. How do I continue on with this walk? And let him explain. You give him 5 minutes of your time. He'll explain that. You come right back out. Your family members, friends will wait for you. So follow him. He'll get that information to your hand. You'll come right back. Your family now. This is your church. Thank you for being patient with us. Thank you for walking with us. Come on, let's encourage them. That's a big step. Good job.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow, you repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me. And then he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.